السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين
What was the promised Messiah, peace be upon him's practice, of working hard and making strenuous efforts? And what was his routine to stay in good shape and keep his body fit and active? Hazrat Muslih Ma'ud, may Allah be pleased with him, describes this and says, he was the complete opposite of being lazy and slack. Rather, he toiled extremely hard. Although he preferred solitude and seclusion, strenuous efforts never faced him. On many occasions, when he was on a journey, he would send off the horse ahead with his servant, and he would walk for 20 to 25 miles by foot himself and reach his destination. In fact, he would more often travel by foot and ride less often. He continued this habit of walking by foot until a very elderly age, even crossing the age of 70, when he was suffering from very serious illnesses. He would often daily go out for a walk for 4 to 5 miles. Sometimes he would walk for 7 miles. He would relate his condition before reaching his elderly age, and he says that when he would wake up before the morning prayer, he would go for a walk, and he would walk until he reached Batala. We're on the same road, approximately 5.5 miles from Qadian. He would reach a village in time for the morning prayer. Thus, this is the example for us. This is particularly the example for the Waqfeen-e Zindagi, the life devotees, who are entrusted with serving the Jamaat, the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, among whom this relates foremost to the Murabbiyan, the missionaries. To keep fit and healthy and a strong physical condition, they should develop the habit of daily exercise and walks. If due to time constraints, going out for a walk is not possible, then they must take out time somewhere to exercise. The physical condition of some young murabbiyan or some young missionaries expresses their lack of exercise. When questioned, they reply that they used to exercise before, but they have stopped doing so for some time. Considering the importance of the work entrusted to our Murabbiyan, to our missionaries, they should ensure they keep themselves physically fit, healthy and active. They should give regular attention towards exercise. The missionaries from the foreign Jamiats outside of the UK are also sent to Rabwa for their training after completing their studies, where they are also given a medical checkup or analysis. Dr. Nuri Sahib, who is a heart specialist there, wrote to me that, MashaAllah, the missionaries are excellent in every respect. However, some are at a very dangerously overweight level. Such missionaries should give heed to this. And when they enter the field, they give even less attention to this issue. Hence, first of all, our missionaries and life devotees must do some form of exercise or the other. Secondly, they should abstain from unhealthy food, which is very common and is called junk food in these Western countries. So take care of this. If missionaries are alone in their homes, then they should be able to find time for this. And in such instances where they are without family, a missionary should have some know-how of cooking food. In any case, attention should be given to this. I am not merely advising you about this, rather I myself regularly exercise on an exercise bike as well as other exercise machines with the grace of Allah. Allah the Almighty has up to now given me the ability to continue doing so. Nonetheless, we require fit and healthy life devotees and missionaries. They should be mindful that in order to perform their duties in an excellent fashion, they should not show slackness in terms of their health. Hazrat Muslih Ma'ul, may Allah be pleased with him, relates another narration with reference to the promised Messiah, peace be upon him. Nowadays, we convey our voice everywhere through loudspeakers. As a result, many of us have lost the habit of being able to speak in a loud voice, or this ability has become somewhat restricted. The religious teachers and missionaries should especially remember that they should practice speaking loudly. For when they go out in the field to preach or to do tabligh, there will be instances where loudspeakers are unavailable. This is particularly true in poorer countries. In past times, there was no means to convey one's voice, and huge efforts were made with great difficulty to convey sound in crowds and in gatherings. Thus, people would practice to increase the level of their voices. Normally, the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wassalam, on whom be peace, would speak very softly and in a low tone. However, what was the state of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, when the need arose and he had to enlighten the world with the teachings of Islam? Hazrat Muslih Ma'ud, may Allah be pleased with him, illustrating this with one example, says, the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, was in the largest lecture hall in Lahore, which was packed with people, and he stood up to deliver his speech or address. There was such overcrowding that the doors were left open and long lines of people stretched outside. As was normal, when he began speaking, the promised Messiah, peace be upon him's voice, was somewhat dim, and people in the crowd were making noise. However, afterwards, as he spoke, it seemed as if somebody was sounding a trumpet from the heavens, and people sat captivated. Hence, Hadhrat Muslih Maud says that raising the level of one's voice is necessary in serving the religion in some circumstances. Sometimes it becomes essential to raise the volume of one's voice to serve the religion. Thus, those who are entrusted with this responsibility should give special attention to this matter. Sometimes people express great concern that they are unable to maintain a single consistent level of piety, and rather it fluctuates. This is something very good in one sense, because it means a person is constantly assessing his or her own state. A person questions why he or she is not maintaining a previous state of piety or of enthusiasm in prayers and worship, and he questions why this standard has declined. He or she becomes extremely concerned lest the lower state persists and becomes worried for how this can be overcome. And so, nonetheless, this is a very good thing. However, at other times, what happens is that there is no goodness in this fluctuation, and it is simply a case of a person passing through phases of higher and lower grades of piety and goodness. A Sahaba, a companion of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, once came to him and said, "Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, I am a hypocrite, because when I sit in your company, my state is at one level, and when I get up and am no longer in your presence, my condition is otherwise." In other words, his standard of goodness and purity of the heart would not remain the same when he exited the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's company. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "This is precisely the mark of a mu'min, of a true believer. You are not a hypocrite." And so naturally, through his spiritual power, being in the presence of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had an effect on those present or who came to learn from him with a pure heart and with the intention of elevating their relationship with God the Almighty. Leaving the company of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw a diminishing of this standard. But nonetheless, the companions of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam undoubtedly had a fear of God in their hearts. They had sincerity and they had devotion. Thus, they would become worried lest the diminishing of the standard of piety continued in them for a long period of time, and they moved away from the religion. They would become concerned lest any hypocrisy enter them. This was the mentality of the companions. When a person thinks on similar lines to this, he or she will give attention to prayers and to istighfar and to improving their condition. Whilst commenting on this subject, Hadhrat Muslih Ma'ud, may Allah be pleased with him, states that the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, would often say that some children remain healthy due to the overly worrisome and excessively anxious nature of their mothers. If the child feels a small amount of pain, the mother worries for the worst, worrying about what will happen and what the outcome will be. The result of this is that she ensures the treatment is carried out thoroughly, preventing the illness from spreading further or becoming dangerous. However, there are some mothers who only detect the illness in their child once it becomes rooted and difficult to treat. Hence, the apprehensive nature of a mother is very beneficial for the health. The Promised Messiah, peace be upon him, also stated that the overly worrisome nature of the mother is beneficial for the good health of the child. Similarly, in its own right, being apprehensive and worrying about whether one will suffer an illness is very beneficial. For example, as far as spirituality is concerned, if there is a decrease in spirituality or worship, or there is a decline in the virtuous deeds one is performing, and one feels apprehensive and questions, am I moving completely away from God? Then this worrisome nature is beneficial. So he says, a person readies himself to face dangers and perils, and he protects himself from the impending onslaughts. Thus, those who truly progress spiritually and fashion their nature in line with the commandments of God the Almighty are the ones who worry like an overly anxious mother, questioning themselves whether the lack of prayers and the lack of worship is down to their own weaknesses or sinful ways, and they do so lest they contract an incurable spiritual illness of the kind that spreads far and wide as a result of it. The Sahaba, the companions of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, were so blessed that when they would ponder over their own condition, they would worry and go in the company of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They would heal themselves through the spiritual power of the Holy Prophet, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. However, we should constantly ponder over our worship, prayer, and repentance with the same level of worry, and through it find a cure for ourselves. If we are unnecessarily worrisome, then that is better than showing carelessness about God. For sometimes carelessness leads one away from God, and slowly one moves away from faith and religion. Resulting in one becoming a patient of an incurable spiritual illness. Thus, it is vital to be extremely mindful in this regard. On one occasion, Hazrat Musleh Maud, may Allah be pleased with him, was discoursing that the relationship between happiness and sorrow is due to our sense of perception. For example, if there is an upcoming wedding in a family, even if they have to take a loan to ensure the success of the wedding, they will do so happily, and their relatives will also be present in their joyful occasion. However, for those who have no connection with that wedding, for them to have a successful wedding or their relatives and friends to enjoy the wedding proceedings, the taking of the loan, as well as the hard work that has been put into it, all carry no meaning whatsoever. What is it to them who is happy or not, or who takes a loan to ensure its success or otherwise? Similarly, if a person who is the guardian of a household passes away, then there is a general feeling of sorrow and mourning in the house where the person has died. However, for a third person who has no connection with them, the passing away of the guardian bears no significance at all. Each day, thousands of people die and their passing away is reported. But for those people who we do not know, we do not have the same emotions and feelings, even if we learn of their passing away. On the other hand, if a close relative of ours passes away, we feel the pain acutely. Then there are those who cause great harm to others, such as tyrants, thieves and robbers, as well as terrorists. They are such that when they die, instead of feeling sorrow, some people generally feel joy that they have died, yet their relatives would feel sorrow. Hazrat Muslih Ma'ud, may Allah be pleased with him, further states, this sentimental attachment is a mysterious phenomenon. By pondering over it, an overwhelming mysterious sense of feeling is observed. One thing can be joyful and a moment of delight for a certain individual, but may be a source of mourning and grief for another. There are also many people who neither partake in anyone's happiness nor in anyone's sorrow. Hazrat Muslih Ma'ud states that the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, explained this subject to me in one phrase. Hazrat Muslih Ma'ud expands further by saying, the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, regularly read the newspaper. This should serve as a lesson for those who are responsible for the propagation of religious affairs, that they should regularly read the news and also go over small news items. Nevertheless, Hadr Muslih Maud states that the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, read the newspaper on a regular basis. One day in 1907, whilst reading the newspaper, he called out for me, saying, Mahmood. He called out in a way that indicated something needed to be done immediately. The promised Messiah, peace be upon him, called Hazrat Muslih Ma'ud in such a way as if something was urgent. Hazrat Muslih Ma'ud further states that when I went to see him, the promised Messiah narrated a new story to me, in which a person, the name of whom I cannot recall, had died. Hazrat Muslih Ma'ud states that upon hearing this, I burst out laughing and asked, what relation do I have with this? The promised Messiah said that in his household, there would be an atmosphere of mourning, and you say, what does that have to do with you? What is the reason for this? Hazrat Muslih Ma'ud said, what is the reason behind this? The reason is that when a person has no connection with another, he can never feel their pain or sorrow. Similarly, if someone is unknown to us is happy, we can never feel that joy. Hazrat Muslih Ma'ud narrated this incident on the occasion of the nikah, the marriage ceremony of Mia Abdus Salam Sahib, the son of Hazrat Khalifatul Masih I, may Allah be pleased with him. Hazrat Muslih Ma'ud expressed his feelings by saying that were Hazrat Khalifatul Masih I alive, how happy would he have been? He would have prayed fervently, and as a result, how many others would have been guided towards praying? Hazrat Muslih Ma'ud stated that this occasion and thought imprints a special feeling in our hearts. If a relative or loved one goes through a joyous occasion, it has a special place in our hearts. Through this thought process, a special spark is ignited at the thought of how our dear one would have prayed for our relatives at this occasion. And this brings a wave of happiness through our bodies. Thus, it should be remembered that we must offer special prayers for those who do good to us and their offspring. On occasions of happiness and sorrow, they should feel for them. Even for the members of our community, it is expected generally that they express their feelings of joy and sorrow because the Jamaat is one entity. We will only have a sense of sentimental attachment if we feel the pain of every member of the community and partake in their joy. And this is a way to build unity. Hazrat Muslih Ma'ud narrated an incident of the level of obedience of Hazrat Khalifatul Masih I. He said, with regards to Hazrat Khalifatul Masih I, I remember that when Abdul Hakim Bhatyalvi, the apostate, was still an Ahmadi, he loved him dearly, and Abdul Hakim also had a close mutual relationship. Even when Abdul Hakim started to oppose the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, he wrote that in your community, that is the community of the promised Messiah, there is no one other than Maulvi Nuruddin who resembles the companions of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Indeed, he is the one that is worthy to take pride over. He states that Abdul Hakim Bhatyalvi had also written a commentary, and he wrote much of it consulting Hadrat Khalifatul Masih I. When Abdul Hakim openly announced his apostasy, I saw that Hadrat Khalifatul Masih I, may Allah be pleased with him, worryingly called for his students. Meaning upon hearing the announcement of apostasy, Hadrat Khalifatul Masih I immediately called his students and said to go straight to my library and bring the commentary of Abdul Hakim. The exegesis he wrote was in the library of Hazrat Khalifatul Masih I. Hazrat Khalifatul Masih I, may Allah be pleased with him, instructed them to remove it immediately, lest God's displeasure descended upon him. Hazrat Musleh Maud states that it was a commentary of the Holy Quran, and many of the verses were written in consultation with Hazrat Khalifatul Masih I. But for fear of suffering God's displeasure due to his apostasy, Hazrat Khalifatul Masih I removed his commentary from his personal library, and in his own thought considered that the book was such that would corrupt the others in the library. Thus, this level of religious regard and honor and fear of God is an example for us. When the Jamaat, the community, takes disciplinary action against someone, then some people object. The one who is being punished says about himself that the action taken against me is erroneous and wrong. An action was not taken against the other person. They say that he was favored. Such objections are nothing new. Such objections were raised in every time period and era. These people raise these objections today, and they used to do so in the past. As such, whilst mentioning about such people, Hazrat Musleh Maud, may Allah be pleased with him, says that the reality is that there is a circle of unity in opinion for the sake of improving the institution. It might be that a disagreement may seem prominent. However, if it is not a source of disorder, then the person who is in disagreement is permitted to be a part of the Jamaat. However, another person may be in an insignificant dispute, but if his disagreement is a source of disorder, then he is expelled from the Jamaat. Once someone asked the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, on whom be peace, that I used to be a Shia and now I have left Shiaism. He said, I consider Hadrat Ali, may Allah be pleased with him, superior to Hadrat Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, and Hadrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, because Shiaism maintained a greater effect on him. So he said, therefore, can I take the oath of allegiance on your hands while holding this belief? The promised Messiah, peace be upon him, wrote to him that, yes, you can take the oath of allegiance. However, in contrast, the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, once instructed some people to leave Qadian as a punishment, and he also published an announcement about them. The only reason for this was that they would not be present for the five daily prayers, and some of them would engage in smoking hookah and gossiping. Hazrat Muslih Maud writes that, "Now tell me, what is worse, considering Hadrat Ali superior to Hadrat Abu Bakr, or is it worse to smoke hookah? Surely, every person will say that considering Hadrat Ali, may Allah be pleased with him, superior to Hadrat Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, is worse than smoking hookah, which is a minor thing in comparison. However, the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, allowed a person to take oath of allegiance upon his hands, despite the fact that he held a greater disagreement. And he instructed those who smoked hookah and indulged in vain talk to leave the headquarters." Hazrat Muslim said that on one occasion, an invitation for a feast, the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, arranged for a hookah. When the ambassador of the Turks, Hussein Kami, visited Qadian, and a feast was arranged for him. Hazrat Muslim says that, "I was young, but I remember clearly that in a gathering, the late Maulvi Abdul Karim mentioned that these people are fond of smoking cigarettes. If we do not arrange for something, it will cause discomfort." The promised Messiah, peace be upon him, said, "There is no harm in it. It is not amongst those forbidden acts like drinking alcohol and so on." So the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, expelled that person from the Jamaat for something which is not forbidden, like drinking. And the person who said that, "I consider Hadrat Ali superior to Hadrat Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, despite the fact that the promised Messiah, peace be upon him's own belief was that Hadrat Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him, is superior to Hadrat Ali, may Allah be pleased with him, yet he allowed that person to take the oath of allegiance." Hadhrat Muslih Maud says that actually some things are more serious in terms of causing short-term disorder, but they are insignificant in reality, and some things are insignificant in terms of causing temporary disorder, but they are more grave in reality. Therefore, in terms of preventing temporary disorder, a significant matter is ignored, but action is taken upon an insignificant matter. But those who raise objections have never used common sense. Their purpose is to only criticize. And many people speak for others. Some people become supporters of those who are given disciplinary action. They are oblivious to the facts, and they do not know why someone is being disciplined. So in this regard, people should not interfere without reason, nor should they intercede on their behalf. Yes, when the institution thinks it is appropriate, the matter is reconsidered, and they are also pardoned. People who criticize like this, as I have stated, are also present today. They indulge in wrongful acts. When they are punished, instead of reforming themselves, they speak against the institution. And they also demand that they will remain as we are. Yet despite this, they say that the institution of the Jamaat should make them a part of the system. They will not reform themselves. I would like to clarify here once again that although the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, arranged for the Turkish ambassador something for his need, which was not forbidden as mentioned in the incident, however, the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, had immense dislike towards smoking hookahs. And on some occasions, he has expressed tremendous disgust towards it. What means should be used for tabligh, propagation, and how should it be done? Regarding this, Hazrat Muslih Maud, may Allah be pleased with him, stated on one occasion that at this time the Nizarat-e-Dawat-e-Tabligh propagates through pamphlets or leaflets. They distribute pamphlets and brochures, but the pamphlet is such a thing that its burden cannot be tolerated for a long time. Hazrat Muslih Maud says that during the time of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, tabligh was done through announcements and adverts. Those announcements or adverts used to be 2 to 4 pages long and will cause an uproar in the country. These announcements or adverts would be published in large numbers. According to that time, large numbers would be 1,000 to 2,000. Sometimes 10,000 announcements would be published. But now our Jamaat is 20 times manifold. Now the publication of announcements and leaflets would be to publish 50,000 to 100,000 announcements. Then see how these announcements will attract people's attention. It is the grace of Allah the Almighty that in some places news now gets to millions of people, and this has an effect on other countries as well. There was news from America that there is a Swiss news agency or television. They contacted our representative there that in Sweden there is much attention being directed towards Islam. In that regard, they wanted to hear what Islam is and why this is happening. For this reason, they wanted to interview him. So attention is being directed in this manner as well. During my tour there, the message reached hundreds of thousands of people. So anyways, the message reaches in a vast scale through announcements, adverts, news or press that cannot be reached through regular literature. Hazrat Musleh Maud, may Allah be pleased with him, says that if announcements were published 12 times a year before, then now even if they are published thrice a year and make it 2 to 4 pages, but published in 100,000 to 200,000, then it will be known how they have caused a stir. And now we witness that it causes a stir when they are published in hundreds of thousands. For this reason, sometimes certain people say that what is the point of publishing an advertisement in newspapers? It is beneficial to publish announcements because the introduction of the Jamaat reaches the people through the circulation of these newspapers. Whereas the literature which is distributed in 2 months, sometimes through a newspaper, that same information reaches a greater number of people in 1 day. As I have stated, by the grace of Allah, the Almighty, the Jamaat is being introduced through newspapers in many places. By the grace of Allah, the Almighty, the communities, the Jamaat's press and media department is playing a huge role in this regard. And this work is being done on a large scale across the world. Thus, the Department of Tabligh should take full advantage from this initial introduction and convey the true teachings of Islam through these means. It should not be the case that an advert only appears once in the newspaper and then nothing further is done. Rather, it is then the job of the Tabligh department to utilize these means for the purpose of Tabligh. This initial introduction should then be used for the purpose of Tabligh, and new ways should be sought for doing Tabligh. Once Hazrat Musleh Maud wrote an article for the Tarbiyat, the moral training of children, in which he mentioned a story that was narrated by the promised Messiah, peace be upon him. He writes, on the 5th of September 1898, after the Asr prayer, the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, narrated the following story upon my request. From this story, it was evident that placing one's trust and belief in God the Almighty and practicing true taqwa, righteousness, can make one worthy of God Almighty becoming his guardian himself and fulfilling his needs in such a way that one is not even aware. The promised Messiah, peace be upon him, narrated, a noble man was once travelling somewhere and happened to pass through a jungle where a thief used to live. The thief would raid anyone travelling through the jungle, and as per his habit, he also planned to raid on this noble man. However, the noble man responded to the thief by saying, وَفِي السَّمَاءَ رِزْقُكُمْ وَمَا تُوْعَدُونَ, and in heaven is your sustenance, and also that which you are promised. In other words, if you place your trust in God the Almighty and adhere to taqwa, then your sustenance is in heaven. If you give up on stealing, then God Almighty will fulfill your needs himself. This had such an impact on the thief that he let this nobleman go free and he began practicing what he had said. The remaining part of the story is that thereafter, this person began to receive sumptuous food served in gold and silver utensils. Thus, the moral of the story is that he used to steal, but after giving up on this habit of stealing and placing his trust in God the Almighty, he began receiving food that was served in gold and silver utensils. After eating the food, he would throw the utensils outside his shack. Incidentally, the same nobleman happened to pass by again from there, and the thief, who had now become very pious and righteous, related the whole incident to the nobleman and asked him to tell him another verse. And he replied by saying, فَوَرَبِّ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ إِنَّهُ لَحَقٌّ. And by the Lord of the heaven and the earth, it is certainly the truth. Hearing these noble words, it had such an impact on him that he trembled with the mere thought of God Almighty's greatness and majesty and passed away in this very state. So this was the story that the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, narrated to a young 8 to 12-year-old child. And Hadhrat Muslim Maud is further telling the children in the article that through taqwa, one is granted such wealth that after that, can there be any doubt in the existence of God the Almighty, who provides for all those living in the heavens and in the earth? He is a holy and true God who nourishes and nurtures us. Therefore, fear Him alone. Place your trust in Him and become pious. This was the condition of the children in the time of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him. And this is the lesson they were being taught, which today is difficult for even the adults to understand. Thus, every one of us should always remember to adhere to taqwa and have such strong belief in the existence of God Almighty and then remain firm on it. Because He alone is the one who nourishes us. He is the one who nurtures us. And there is no doubt that He is the holy and true God. We should fear Him alone. We should always implore Him alone. We should bow down only before Him. We should place our trust in Him alone. For this is true piety and is incumbent upon a Muslim to adhere to it, believe in it, and practice it. This story has an even greater importance for the adults than the children. In today's day and age, whereby people are forgetting this, and at times certain people move away from God Almighty, and instead of placing their trust in God Almighty, they begin to trust people more. Such people should remember that they should place their trust in God Almighty alone. May God the Almighty enable all of us to develop this taqwa, this righteousness. After the prayer, I shall lead two funeral prayers in absentia. One of the funeral prayers is for Al-Hajj Dr. Adris Bangora Sahib, Naib Amir 1 of Sierra Leone, who passed away on the 3rd of May 2016 after a short ailment. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Surely to Allah we belong and to Him we shall return. He accepted Ahmadiyyat while studying in school in the city of Bo. In 1966, he became a member of the Majlis-e-Amla, and thereafter, until his demise, he had the opportunity to serve the Jamaat in various capacities. He served for a very long time as the Deputy Emir 1. He was a very successful Muballigh preacher, and many people accepted Ahmadiyyat through him. Despite living at a long distance from the mosque, he would offer his Fajr, Maghrib, and Isha prayer in the mosque. On his day off, he would spend his day from morning until Asr in the mosque and would spend this time reciting the Holy Quran and offering Nawafil, the voluntary prayers. He was regular in offering his Friday prayers and also in watching MTA and listening to the sermons of the Khalifa. He would always be reading a book of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, and would be ready to help anyone who is in need of help. Although he was a medical doctor by profession, it was as if he had devoted his entire life for the service of the Jamaat. Akil Ahmed Sahib, regional missionary of Bo, writes, if any member of the Jamaat came with a request and there was no provision for it in the budget, that is, when someone would approach the missionary with a request, the missionary would take them to Dr. Sahib. And there was never an instance where someone was taken to him and he was not given any help. The deceased was a very loving and kind human being. He would take care whilst treating the life devotees, and if any medicine was available with him, he would give it to them for free of cost and would request for prayers in return. He would treat the poor for free and in fact would also cover their travel expense. He did operations for many people free of the patients suffering from hernia. When his health weakened and any patient would come, he would send them to the hospital and pay for their fees himself. Through him, a very sincere Ahmadi doctor, Al-Haj Sheikh Tamu Sahib, did the bet and offered a small piece of land as a gift to the Jamaat. When Dr. Bangora Sahib learned that although he had joined later, yet he had exceeded in his level of sacrifice, he gave a piece of land in the center of the city to the Jamaat for a mosque to be built there. Similarly, he gave 35 million Leon towards the construction of the mosque. The deceased had great love for Ahmadiyyat and was a very pious individual who prayed with great sincerity for Khilafat Ahmadiyyat. He was a Musi and actively took part in other financial schemes also. These people are those who, although live in far-off lands, but by the grace of God the Almighty, when they accept the faith, they continue progressing in it. May God the Almighty elevate his station and establish Ahmadiyyat in his future generations, and may they always have a bond of loyalty. The second funeral prayer is for Mansura Begum Sahiba, the wife of Khalid Saifullah Khan Sahib, who is the Naib Amir of Australia. She passed away on the 21st of July 2016 in Australia. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Surely to Allah we belong and to Him we shall return. She was a very pious lady who was regular in her salat, devout in prayers, regular in tahajjud prayer, had great regard for Ahmadiyyat and had immense love for Khilafat. Even while in hospital, she would be very mindful of her salat, and due to her final illness, she would forget to offer her salat, and so she would ask her husband to read it with her. She had the opportunity to serve as Sadr Lajna Imaillah of Australia, Sadr Lajna Imaillah Libya, and also had the opportunity to serve in Tarbela and Civil in Lahore. She would always work by forming a team. She had great love for the Holy Quran and would recite it regularly. Apart from her own children, she also had the opportunity to teach the Holy Quran to other non-Ahmadi children. She was a Musiya and was very diligent in paying her chanda. Her chanda for her income and on her property had already been paid for the year 2016. Apart from her husband, she leaves behind two sons and three daughters. All of them are serving the Jamaat in various capacities. One of her sons, Umar Khalid Sahib, lives here in the UK and is president of one of the local Jamaats in London. Her other son is the National Secretary of Waqf-e-Jadeed in Australia. May God the Almighty elevate the deceased station and treat her with forgiveness and mercy. May this devotion and loyalty remain established in her future generations.
Alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inu. Alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nu'minu bihi wa natawakkalu alayhi wa na'uzu billahi min shururi anfusina ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله عباد الله رحمكم الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل واللسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله يذكركم وادعوه يستجب لكم وَلَذِكْرُ اللَّهِ أَكْبَرُ